Bye, y'all. Bye, girls. Bye. Study about Jesus, okay? Amen, amen. I want to praise God because today we come to the last sermon preaching through 1st and 2nd Thessalonians. And what a journey for me being deep in these little letters that Paul sent. And I hope it's been a blessing for you. The thing that comes to mind is the issue of grace throughout Paul's writings, and especially in these letters. So pray with me as we go back to 2 Thessalonians chapter 3, hopefully finishing today. Father, we thank you for your word. I pray, Lord, that you'll be with me as I, and help me as I read, as I share the word, as I preach. I pray, Holy Spirit, that you would fill me and just take over, finish strong these powerful little letters to that church back in the day and to us. Help us to live it. Help us to know it. Please help your servant today. It is in Jesus' name we pray, and all God's children said,
amen.
Okay. Moving and breathing in his church. Let's start by doing this. Name some of the greatest athletes, or who you think might be the greatest athlete of any sport. Just, you may think of a handful, but in your lifetime, somebody that, or before, somebody that you've observed doing great feats as an athlete, as a sports figure. Name somebody.
Nadia Comaneci.
Okay. Nadia Comaneci. Gymnast, right?
Michael Jordan.
Okay.
Art Monk.
Okay. Greatest of all time. He's good.
All right.
He's good. All right. Someone else.
Deion Sanders.
Staubach. Tebow.
Sanders.
Barry Sanders. Get that man. Who? Jim Thorpe. Some of y'all are dating yourselves, but that's okay.
Peyton Manning.
Who? Peyton Manning? Okay.
Well,
the Peyton, so good job, guys. You get the point. So these are great athletes. I mean, you got your Tom Brady's, get guys like that. You know how to get that in there. You got your guys that are just phenomenal athletes. But here's the thing that's consistent with every last one of them. They all need rest when they're in the middle of one of their games or events. They don't get out there and go non-stop throughout the game. Now, some try to, and in Little League, sometimes we would make players go both ways. That means coaching football, they play on offense and defense. But even then, they wouldn't play on special teams. Sooner or later, they need a rest. They need a break. Amen? Everyone needs a break. Everyone needs to rest, and God made it that way. Amen? No one, no matter how good you are at what you do, you are supposed to seek God out and rest with him frequently. Amen?
Amen.
You know where this is going? Is it pretty obvious where we're going today? Yeah. This is preaching to a church that's little but full of hard workers. So here we go, bringing us home. Paul concludes his second letter to the Thessalonians, in the face of suffering, they were encouraged to go forward. Praise God. We've covered every verse, as I've said, and God willing, today we finish. We should never finish living out God's word, however. Please don't put this letter away forever. In fact, if you missed one, they're all out there on the World Wide Web on our web page. You can check out this letter at any time, because, or you can just read it in your home. Don't ever put this letter away for good, because it is filled with things that we need to know to help us live. Amen? So we review by reading today what we've covered so far in this chapter. Please stand out of reverence to God and His Word. 2 Thessalonians chapter 3. Holy Spirit, please help me as I read. Finally, brethren, pray for us that the word of the Lord may have free course and be glorified, even as it is with you, and that we may be delivered from unreasonable and wicked men. For all men have not faith, but the Lord is faithful, who shall establish you and keep you from evil. And we have confidence in the Lord touching you, that ye both do and will do the things which we commanded you. And the Lord direct your hearts into the love of God and into the patient waiting for Christ. Now we command you, brethren, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that ye withdraw yourselves from every brother that walketh disorderly and not after the tradition which he received of us. For yourselves know how ye ought to follow us, for we behave not ourselves disorderly among you, neither did we eat any man's bread for naught, but wrought with labor and travail night and day, that we might not be charged to any of you. Not because we have not power, but to make ourselves an example, that is, an example unto you to follow us. For even when we were with you, this we commanded you, that if any man would not work, neither should he eat. For we hear that there are some which walk among you disorderly, working not at all, but are busybodies. Now them that are such we command and exhort by our Lord Jesus Christ, that with quietness they work and eat their own bread. Praise God for His word. That brings us to verse 13. Please be seated. Take rest. Take a rest. Take a rest. I really want you to mark this sermon down, because I want you to rest. But more important than me, God wants you to rest. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. We don't have to go 7 days a week. I'm preaching it myself, as preachers often say. We don't need to go 7 days a week for God to get His work done. Did you hear me? How many of you have ever worked 7 days in a row? How many of you have done that for a long period of time? How many of you know that God doesn't want that? Well, I've got to make a living, Pastor. I've got to feed my family. The boss says I got to do it. I believe that if you consult God about finding that day when you can rest, that God's going to make that happen for you. And maybe if your boss or your pastor or someone is telling you otherwise, God help me if I'm doing that to you. If someone is telling you otherwise, that you need to work 7 days a week, and oh God, don't worry, God will let that one slide. I suggest you go back to Jesus and tell Jesus what your boss or what your pastor said, or your wife said, or your husband said. I'm about to get in trouble, ain't I? Or anyone says, go back to Jesus and see what He says again about it. And see if He can't make a way for you to rest and get that day that you need to restore your physical being, your emotional being, your mind, your heart, and spend that time with Jesus. Amen? Amen. So, take a rest. Verse 13. But ye, brethren, be not weary in well-doing. We got a load of well-doers here. People that do well for Jesus. They serve Him. They give of their time. And I just praise God for that. Now, as sure as there were a percentage, as we've learned last week, of busybodies and sluggards in the church at Thessalonica, I am guessing also there was a greater, far greater percentage that served Jesus relentlessly, serving over and above the call, and maybe doing things they weren't called to do. They made their living Monday through Saturday, or Monday through Friday. They fed their family, and the time that they were off, and even while they were at work, they were looking to serve Jesus often and always. And that is the case here, right here, Ensley First Baptist Church. Serving Jesus always. I know as I observe and watch y'all, and I see some of you retired and you keep on serving Jesus. Some of you are still working and you've turned your workplace into your mission field and you keep on serving Jesus. Plus, you come here and give up your time when you're not at your job. I just want to applaud that. Praise God. Amen. Everybody, let's give Jesus praise. Amen. Now that said, you got the applause, but I come with caution today, as you've already heard. I'm preaching to hard workers. I'm so thankful for the workers at this church. I'm so thankful for all the workers that God sends from other churches. Amen?
Amen.
People at other churches, some of them churches are so big, they're looking for stuff to do and they're twiddling their thumbs. And God says, hey, there's a little church over there that works with the homeless. Why don't you go over there and help? And many of the pastors endorse that. Thank God for them. There's a mission field in their backyard, and they come and they help us here. Isn't that awesome?
Yes.
There's a man and a husband and wife in this room right now that are here for just a little while, and the first thing they did is they contacted me and said, can we work while we're here? And sir, the answer is yes. Well, take a rest nonetheless while you're here, right? Thank you. So, you work full-time jobs. Some of you have, you've retired. This church knows about work. We talked about that. Then you serve Jesus up here. And so, I'd say right in this moment, slow down, reflect, take a look around, ask the Holy Spirit right now, internally or whisper it. I guess you can shout it. We're at a Baptist church. Ask the Holy Spirit right now, am I taking the rest that I need to serve you at my full capacity? What does he say? I want to say, keep up the hard work for Jesus, but just be careful. You should be praying about what you're doing and what you're supposed to be doing. I can speak from error, from making the same mistake. And I'll ask the question as I speak of myself, have you ever done work that God probably didn't call you to do? Preacher asked you to do something, and I've asked you to do something. Surely I've gotten the way of God by putting too much on you. And I confess that is sin, okay? Mark down the date. Yeah, you said it. I said it. I try not to. Now, asking is not a problem. It has to be a thing where we come together and seek who? The Holy Spirit, right? And so, but I've done the same thing. I've taken on things. And in a little church, it's easy because we try to walk by faith and push the envelope and do extra things. And then, so normally, the workers just kind of fall in line. Well, I can do that. So we got to check with the Holy Spirit and what we're supposed to be doing and what we're not supposed to be doing. I think there's many, 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 many reasons why the Holy Spirit slowed down Future and Hope, and we can't get into all of them today, but God is the great designer. He's the architect. They're great architects, but ultimately they work for God, and God is weaving everything together, and it happens in His timing, so just the right people are trained at just the right time to do just the right work for Jesus. Amen?
Amen.
And it says, be not weary in well-doing. We don't want to be weary, because when we're weary, we're not as effective. Back to the athlete, you mentioned some great athletes. If you never took your best player, if he never had a break, let's say he played on offense and defense and special teams and whatever the sport may be. What was the gymnast you mentioned?
Nadia.
What if Nadia never stopped? And she did every event. I mean, what if they never took a break? They're not going to be near as effective as if they are full strength They get their rest, they get their timeouts, they get what they need, they get the water, the nutrition they need, they get the food they need spiritually. Go ahead and just cross that over for a minute. Be in the Word of God, the bread of life being Jesus, feed off of Jesus. He's the living water. Drink in Jesus. Take care of yourself. Get away and take a break, or else you're not going to be as effective as God wants you to be. Amen? He's shown us in so doing and making us this way that we need Him, because if we did everything on our own, and even if we were good at it, we might start to think we don't need Him. So weariness comes with good purpose. When you start to feel you're getting weary, take that break, slow it down. The language in these verses, don't fail in heart or faint. Anybody ever fainted? I've never fainted like because of some bad news, but I remember two-a-day practices in high school at the end. I mean, believe it or not, it gets into the 80s and 90s in Michigan, August in Michigan, when we brought football practice, and I'm out there just trying to do better than everybody else. I'm doing the wind, you know, the gut busters, the wind sprints, and I remember I was trying to show off to the coaches, and the next thing you know, I crossed the end zone during one of our practices on the football field, and boom, lights went out, and I was down. Nobody touched me. I was just running, and I was so gassed, so out of it, I went down. Next thing you know, I wake up in the trainer's table, like, where am I? The coach was real proud, but he's like, never do that again, right? So fainting, if you're working for Jesus, and you are so exhausted from work, so exhausted from serving here, and you're starting to lose the reason why you're doing it, I demand you to do what the Word of God says and take some time, amen, to get away. So we're going to take seriously God's caution signs. And He gives plenty of caution signs in this race to run with Jesus. On the narrow road, He gives us caution signs. There's a lot of directions the Holy Spirit could have taken me, but I love where He brought me for this. You'll see in a moment. I've seen examples of Christians that come here, awesome people, come here, and they are going 100 miles an hour in everything they're doing. Some of you are in this room, I won't mention any name. They come here at 100 miles an hour, doing everything they can, but some of them, not that are in this room, they come in like gangbusters, but then they kind of fade and start to faint from the work because they're just overloaded, doing way more than they should have. That's partly my fault. I should caution that more. And likely they do stuff that God never called them to do. Then they crash and no longer serve. We don't want that. We don't want that, right? We got to watch each other. We got to do that. What are some signs you're becoming weary while serving Jesus? Well, I'm going to share. Whoops. Go ahead. Somebody said something? Now it's quiet. Did somebody say something, or am I hearing things? If I'm hearing things, let's hope it's the Holy Spirit. Okay. You don't want your pastor hearing the wrong voices. Amen? What are some signs you're becoming weary while serving Jesus? The fruit of the Spirit is, I think, where we need to go. Turn to Galatians 5. And I think, pray with me, I think we're heading into the letter to Galatians next as we go forward. But turn to Galatians 5, fruit of the Spirit, Galatians 5:22. So, and you can think about all the things that happen here, but serving in streets, okay, think fruit of the Spirit as we examine ourselves today. There's a song that Maddie kind of wrote, I kind of helped her, that we do. She's done that song here on this stage, and I want to do that right now. Not because I want to impress anybody with the voice God gave me, because we know that's not the case, but because the words are about what you're about to hear in the fruit of the Spirit. So, you ready? Listen to the words. The fruit of the Spirit has come from above, Love, joy, and peace, patience and kindness and goodness too, gentleness, faithfulness, self-control. These are the... I need Maddie. Self-control. Good fruit for you and good fruit for me. Good fruit to pick from our Jesus tree. Good fruit for you and good fruit for me. Good fruit to pick from our Jesus tree. Praise God. And don't ever want to do that again around Maddie, because I choked. We do that at nighttime often, her, Violet, myself, when we do a little prayer, Bible time before they go to bed. And that song is stuck in my head, and it's a good song to have stuck in your head, isn't it? When you're needing to be in the fruit of the Spirit, but maybe you're not, right? So keep that in mind. The fruit of the Spirit. Sometimes the fruit of the Spirit on our Jesus tree, on our tree, we self-examine ourselves, is lacking. And when you look at yourself and you look at the fruit that should be there, and if it's not there, that's a red flag that maybe I need to take a step back and go regroup and take a rest. Amen? Galatians 5:22, let's go through it. But the fruit of the Spirit is love. How many of you ever been unloving to somebody? Okay? Like half of you, the rest of you are always loving. How many of y'all ever been unloving to somebody? There we go. So, if you are serving Jesus at any church, or we're talking about here, and you're serving, and something happens, and suddenly you are finding yourself, the red flag goes up, you look up there, and the love fruit is missing in your life, then maybe you need to regroup and go and pray and take a break. Amen? Amen? That's a sign if the love is lacking. There's joy. If you're serving Jesus and the joy that was once there is fading away, take a step back and take a break. And go find your joy with Jesus, then come back. Amen? That may take a half a day. That may take a week. It may take a couple weeks. If you don't find it in 3 weeks, then we need to have a talk. Right? Peace. In this type of ministry, this church is radically stepping out on faith. I mean, we're doing just things that the world thinks is insane. You're trying to start something like that with no money? The fire marshal said, most people try that, or people that have tried that, they have good intentions, but they don't finish. I got news for him and anybody else that doubts. Not that he was ugly, but I got news for any that are doubting. God has finished everything he started here, and he's going to continue to finish everything he starts here. And I haven't got the faith yet, but that's just the deal. And God will give us peace when Satan wants us to flinch and be unsettled in ourselves, right? And if the work here is stressing you out and your peace is being shaken, an order from your pastor is go take a break and get in the Word and spend some time with Jesus and come back with the peace that passes all understanding. Amen? It must sound today like I'm trying to run you off. No, I want you to be at your full strength when you're here, just like that athlete. Amen? What about long suffering? What is long suffering? It's something everyone in this room is so good at, right? Patience. Debbie's back there laughing. Patience. Are you a patient person? That's the fruit of the Spirit. Long suffering. You want, if you're losing patience at streets, let's say, with somebody that's there, let's say, maybe that's a day you just need to go. Whoever the ops guy is, or maybe it's the ops guy. Maybe it's the operations officer of the day. Whoever it is, if you're losing patience, which would also impact your joy and your love and your peace, if you're losing patience, take a break. It's okay. Do you realize that this church operated before I was even born? I'm not that old. Do you realize that it was operating for Jesus and souls are being saved before I ever knew this place existed? Do you realize that when I'm dead and gone, whether that's this afternoon or years from now, the Holy Spirit, I believe until Jesus comes back, I hope anyway, will still own this place, rule here, and save souls here. It's not about me, it's not about any man, it's about what, it's this is God's, right?
Amen.
So what we stress about here, I promise you, God's not wringing his hands. Amen. Go take a break, right? Go. Even your boss says go take a break. Well, some probably would work you 7 days a week, but most want you to be ready. So if you're stressed out, stop it. There's nothing, Jeff, to stress about. God's got it. Say it. God's got it. Say it again. God's got it. He does. Do you believe that? Say amen.
Amen.
Amen. He's got it. So if you're losing patience and you're stressing out, you don't need to. You don't need to. There's gentleness. We don't need to be barking at people. Jeff, I can bark at them with the best of them. We don't need to bark at each other. A soft answer turns away wrath. There's goodness and there's faith, which we've talked about. We can never give up on anyone. But ones that are hardest for us are those in our own families that we start to flinch about. We can never give up on those in our families that are lost or prodigals. And we definitely don't want to give up on each other. And we don't want to give up on anybody that comes to the street. Why? Because Jesus didn't give up on us. Amen? So keep the faith. Meekness. There needs to be a humble spirit around here at all times. Temperance, that is self-control. And I've sinned in that area too. Wow, we're talking about a lot of my sins today. How about you? Thank God for his forgiveness. Temperance. We cannot lose control around God's house, involved in the ministry, nor at our own homes. Losing it is not a good option when it comes to the fruit of the Spirit. Amen. Now watch this. If any of these things are God and the Holy Spirit saying to you, that's a problem today. Maybe it's something God can help you with right there. You can change on the fly. That's an audible in football, right? The quarterback sees that they're bringing 8-9 in the box, and the run play you got called ain't going nowhere. You change the play at the line for a slant, a pass, and man, bust one for 50 yards, touchdown. So you need to make it audible sometimes. The Holy Spirit says, okay, you weren't so loving to that person. That's an easy fix. How do we do that? We repent. We go to that person and say, look, I just didn't handle that right. That takes some swallowing of
pride.
I didn't handle that so well. Would you forgive me? I do love you. I love it that around here we genuinely tell each other that we love each other. That needs to never stop. That needs to never, never stop. A lot of it comes to, and we're going to cover this a lot. Mindy's going to teach a class on this for Future and Hope with the women. But a lot of it, you said pride, you were correct. Pride is a bad thing. God hates pride. In the middle of sin is the letter I. Right? And a lot of the times, the red flags we get, the times that we're not ministering well, because I is in the center of it. So there's an answer even in these verses, verse 24 of Galatians 5. And they that are Christ have crucified the flesh. What happens when someone's crucified? They die. It's a death sentence. We need to give the flesh, our old man, let the old man die. We need to crucify, kill the old man, our old ways, our old self. Before we were born again, before Jesus Christ saved us, we need to kill that thing every day, and often every moment by moment. And that'll solve a lot of the problems. Sometimes we're working really hard for Jesus for all the wrong reasons. And that's another reason Jesus may slow us down. And they that are Christ have crucified the flesh with the affections and lust. Die to self. Verse 25. If we live in the Spirit, let us also walk in the Spirit. And that concludes that. We want to make sure we recognize the red flag. See if the fruit on our tree is rotten or too ripe or not there at all. And if that be the case, then by all means, go get with Jesus somewhere behind the closet and spend some time with Jesus. Now, I'll talk to you, but I'm just going to tell you the same thing. A lot of the stuff you would think you could bring to a pastor, you can. But I'm going to go with, I don't know the percentage, high 90s. You can take it to Jesus, and let's just make it 100. You go to Jesus first every time. And work it out with the Lord and His Word, right? And then come to me if you want me to praise God with you or pray with you. Jesus gives us the example in deed and in word. We're going to move quickly. Mark this verse down because I'm just giving you the gist. Luke 6:12. Jesus prayed all night with his Father. Now, Jesus felt the importance, the need to get off alone with his Father, and we somehow think that we don't need to. Houston, we have a problem. Houston has a lot of problems. Have you ever noticed that? Ensley, we have a problem. Jesus prayed with his Father. We sang about this in Matthew 11:28-30. Jesus calls us to come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and ye shall find rest for your souls, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light. Then in Mark 2:27, we find, and he, Jesus, said unto them, the Sabbath was made for man, and not man for the Sabbath. I insist, can I give orders? I'm going to give an order. Take your rest. Robert and the rest of y'all. I'm picking on Robert because I just yelled at him Saturday. Take your rest, okay? And you can yell at me if I'm up here 7 days a week. Don't yell. That's not love at all, is it? Let's speak the truth in love, right? You know what I mean. Turn away, we see in verse 14, we're moving. And this is kind of a reminder from something Paul just recently covered in the same chapter, verse 14. And if any man obey not our word by this epistle, by the letter, know that man and have no company with him, that he may be ashamed. Turn away. Paul again addressing church order in this letter. There must have been a problem in Thessalonica, and not surprising, there are problems throughout the body of Christ today with church order. Paul's addressing it. Paul's letter is the word of God. If you agree, say amen. Amen. You can mark down 2 Timothy 3:16-17. So Paul is correcting them. He's correcting rebels. Rebels, we covered this, but let me just quickly say, rebels that disregard God's word. Note that one and don't hang out. That sounds harsh. That's the word of God. Pray the shame of their sin drives them to repentance. Way too much coddling today. Cuddling up with rattlesnakes will get you, right? Let's call sin what the Bible calls sin, even if it means we have to pull away from a brother or sister in Christ. And that's God's word for us. We come to verse 15, turn again. Yet count him not as an enemy, but admonish, that is, caution or warn him as a brother. The goal is to win a fallen believer back, not to get rid of them. Amen? The goal is to bring the believer back into the fold. Jesus wants, he insists, reconciliation. The Holy Spirit, through the Apostle Paul, marked down 2 Corinthians 5:18. Satan loses when a believer is reconciled or restored to the body of Christ. We come to verse 16 through 18. We come to the conclusion of 2 Thessalonians. the conclusion, verse 16. Now, the Lord of peace himself give you peace always by all means. See Philippians 4, 6, and 7. In their trouble was God's peace. God will not always immediately remove the trouble from your life, but he promises us peace that we can't explain. I'll take it, both in good and bad times. Amen? Lord, please pour out your peace on Emsley First Baptist Church. The Lord be with you all. As they moved and breathed, not only his peace, but also his presence. Now, if we're living lives filled with sin, ongoing perpetual sin, if there's a pattern of sin, there is a tendency from experience to pull away from God. But God wants us to humble ourselves, to repent, to turn to him. He'll forgive us of our sins, and then we want his presence in our lives day by day. Verse 17, the salutation of Paul, with mine own hand, which is the token in every epistle, so I write. Now I want you to remember, we've covered this detail per detail. Remember, Paul was dismissing a false letter that was attributed to him. That's why we believe 2 Thessalonians even came about. The Holy Spirit had to correct the record of what Satan was up to. So Paul signs it, and some believe, and I'm one of them, that his eyes were still an issue, and he signs it with his own hand. Verse 18, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. Amen. He leaves them with unmerited favor, the unmerited favor of who? Of Jesus Christ. You can't earn it. You can't keep the law enough. You can't do enough good things serving homeless people. You can't outdo another Christian. You can't look better in God's eyes than another human being. You can't be self-righteous enough to earn God's favor. Unmerited. You can't earn it. He just loves you so much. If you just call on his name, you repent of your sins and you call his name to save you, he, in his grace and mercy and love, saves you. And then that grace, that unmerited favor continues on as you walk with Jesus. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
Because even if you blow it again and do the worst sin in the eyes of the world, and you do something that everybody is going to give up on you, and people are shocked that you would go that far, his grace, it's so amazing. It still amazes me. He'll forgive even that person. Amen. Both of his letters, book in, start with grace, end with grace. 16 years ago, I stood here, flew me down from the great white north. Who does that? You know, it was a God thing. They brought a Yankee in to be the preacher here. Who does that, Pat? And I stood on this stage, Joyce, at a view to a call, and my wife came, I think, a week later, and I preached the gospel here 16 years ago. Truth is, I probably tried to leave at least 16 times, but probably more than that. Y'all, some of y'all were here in the beginning. Some of y'all are brand new. I can say it's only because of God's grace that we're even staying here today. And look at all that's going on in this little bitty church. Look what Jesus is doing. God's grace gave me this woman 31 years ago. I remember times, Joyce, when I was saying, I can't take it anymore. I'm going to go, I don't know what I'll do, but we got to go do something. And Joyce, between your husband, Bob Duke, and my wife,
y'all wouldn't let us quit. So I need the woman to come up here and play the piano. And y'all please stand. If you're here this morning and you never received Christ as your Savior, His grace is available. It's amazing. He'll forgive you. He loves you. He wants to save you. The Bible says that whoever calls on the name of the Lord, they shall be saved. And Joyce, frankly, you and your husband together kept me hanging in there many times in prayer and hugging my neck. So I don't want to cut you. You kept him hanging in there. And it all worked together. So if you need to be saved by Jesus Christ, you come. He says that we're, you know, the Bible's clear, we're all sinners, Romans 3:23. Whoever calls on the name of the Lord, they shall be saved. Saved from hell, saved from ourselves, saved day by day. You need to come forward, you come. If there's any reason you need to pray, you come. Listen to this song, worship through the song. If you need prayer, I'll be here.
Oh,